I'm Calvin Sims. I'm the president of International House, and it is my great pleasure to welcome you here tonight. If you were thinking of doing something else tonight, rest assured you've come to the right place. If you want to know about the Middle East, this is the place to be. You will find no greater repository of experience and information on the Middle East than here with the foreign correspondents of the Overseas Press Club Award. So let's just give the Overseas Press Club a hand. Thank you. So I'm really honored to be co-hosting this event with the OPC. I actually serve as a governor of the organization, and for 22 years, I was a correspondent with the New York Times and a foreign correspondent in South America, in Tokyo, Korea, and Southeast Asia. So for those of you who are joining us for the first time, I thought I'd tell you a little bit about this house, because it is a house. You probably came in through Riverside, but this building goes up 12 stories and goes down 3 stories, and we have 750 residents, as we call them, in this house. They are all graduate students, scholars, and interns from 100 different countries. And this house has been operating for over 90 years, founded by the Rockefeller and Dodge families. And its purpose over these 90 years has been to challenge the residents who live here to be the next generation of global leaders. And we do that by instilling in them the values of empathy, respect, and moral courage through the programs and the partnerships and the facilities that we have here. So if you were to live in this house, and we have a lot of our residents here tonight, you would know what it's like to be challenged every day because everybody here is from someplace else and everybody else is the other. So our residents on a day-to-day basis are constantly being confronted with somebody of a different race, religion, nationality, and they're having to rethink what they believe, what they know, which confirms it and both changes it. And so we've been doing that for 90 years here. And we have about 60,000 alumni around the world. Many of them are distinguished individuals, Nobel laureates, heads of state, award-winning authors and artists, entrepreneurs, CEOs, and journalists. Some of our former iHouse residents include I.M. Pei, the opera great Leontine Price, the former CEOs of Toyota, Eli Lilly, Citigroup, and of course the great madame of journalists, Flora Lewis, actually lived in this house for 3 years when she was at Columbia. So we have here a long and distinguished record of convening thought leaders on international affairs. We hosted Nelson Mandela just 4 months after he was released in 1990. And over the years, our residents have welcomed senators, Supreme Court justices, secretaries of state, and the titans of industry. Our board has been chaired by the former President Gerald Ford, former secretaries of state Henry Kissinger, and General George Marshall. Last year, we hosted on this stage a once-in-a-lifetime event. We had the four living Fed chairs, Janet Yellen, Ben Bernanke, Alan Greenspan, and Paul Volcker, on this stage in conversation with Fareed Zakaria. But tonight, we have a special treat for you. We're thrilled, as I said, to assemble the greatest repository of people who know about the Middle East with this Middle East reunion of the Overseas Press Club. And so with that, I welcome you here. You're going to have a very good evening, and I'm pleased now to introduce Patricia Krantz, who's the Executive Director of the Overseas Press Club. And I'd like to say that Patty, as we call her, has a distinguished record on her own. She served as a journalist, as the Moscow Bureau Chief for Business Week, and in senior editing capacities at the New York Times and Reuters. And you will find no greater advocate for foreign reporting than Patty Krantz. Welcome, Patty.
Thank you, Calvin. I'm very pleased to be here. I myself went to Columbia to the School of International Affairs. Now it's called School of International and Public Affairs. So Columbia is close to my heart. And Calvin mentioned he's a governor of the Overseas Press Club. He's modest. He's actually one of the vice presidents, as is Deborah Amos, our moderator. So there's a lot of synergies between the Overseas Press Club and International House. I'm just going to say a few words about the Overseas Press Club. I know some of you here are members because Calvin and International House graciously paid for memberships and the big ID press badges for over 20 journalism students here at International House. So we're very happy to see you and have you here. The Overseas Press Club was started 78 years ago by American correspondents who covered the beginnings of World War II. And one of our main goals is to uphold the highest standards of international journalism. And the way we do that is to have an annual awards competition every year. It's very timely. The judges are still reviewing all of the entries from stories produced in 2016. And on April 27th, the awards will be given, 22 of them here in New York City at the Mandarin Hotel. We also are dedicated to defending press freedom anywhere that's needed, which now includes the United States. And yesterday, our board released a letter urging President Trump to stop his attacks on the press. We do many programs like the one tonight, and for those of you who are students here, we have another one at Columbia, March 22nd. It's a book night. One of the Columbia journalism professors, Judith Matloff, who covered Moscow like I did, she wrote a book called No Friends But the Mountains, Dispatches from the World's Violent Highlands, and that will be at the journalism school on 116th Street. We do other reunions like this. We had a Russia Hands reunion, and we do purely social events once a month down at the Half King Pub, which is on 23rd Street near the High Line. And it's a great place for people to come and just have a good time with other journalists. As I mentioned, some of you here have it, but one of the services we now offer journalists is a press ID card, which is more and more necessary as news organizations reduce the ranks and governments become more demanding. So freelancers or even people from other news that work full-time for a news organization find the photo ID cards very useful. One of my former friends from who covered Moscow when I did, he writes stories for the New York Times Magazine, but he joined the OPC because when he wanted to go back to Russia, they wanted a press ID. So you never know. And the other thing we do is our sister organization, the Overseas Press Club Foundation, provides scholarships every year to graduating journalists. Ben Taub, one of the panelists tonight, was a fellow a couple years ago. So we hope you enjoyed this event. Thank you again to Calvin and Sharon for helping us do it, and I'm sure you'll enjoy it. So now I will introduce Deb Amos, who, as I said, is a vice president of the Overseas Press Club, but more importantly, she has been a major journalist for many years, and she covered the Middle East for NPR. Now she is here. She's very prescient. She's got a good news sense. She, before Trump was elected, she asked to be a domestic correspondent reporting on refugees in America, which is one of the hottest beats you can have now. So I introduce Deb. Thank you.
Welcome to our panel. I'm going to introduce our panelists one by one, and they can come up on the stage. First is Ben Taub, a writer for The New Yorker, knows a great deal about Syria and the Middle East. Leila Fadel, a correspondent for National Public Radio. At the moment, she is a Murrow Fellow at the Council on Foreign Relations. And Mohamad Bazzi, a recovering former journalist, who is now a professor at NYU. You know, when we were asked to do this panel and have this evening, since we're all friends, I can tell you that we've had a revolving door of panelists because people work. And especially if you're a Middle East correspondent, you get called to go. And you can't really say, oh gosh, I have a panel at the International House, you have to go. So, you know, people have come and gone on this panel, and when you start thinking about focusing it, it makes it a little difficult because we weren't really sure who was going to be here tonight. And at some moment I said, let's just bring all 82 of you up here. You can all be on the panel. So I think one of the ways that we do this, because you're as smart as we are on the region, is we will talk a bit, and then we will open it to questions, and I think that we will all learn something from each other. We're all watching the Middle East. We're all watching it in the age of Trump. The landscape has changed fundamentally since the last administration, and I hope that we can address where we're going, if we know yet, and what the consequences will be. So I wanted to ask each of the panelists to just spend about 3 minutes, you know, talking about what they're doing and, you know, where they think the region is going in their sort of area of expertise. And then I'll ask some questions, and then we will open it to the floor. And our first questioners will be students here from International House. So let me start with Ben.
Sure. So for the past couple of years, I've been working on writing about Syria with a specific focus on war crimes, investigations, and political obstacles to accountability. And in that respect, I think we're entering an increasingly troubled time, as I guess in frankly every other respect. But if you take, for instance, looking at Syria, which is, it's the conflict in which the largest and most damning collection of evidence in history has taken place, and yet there is no path whatsoever to prosecution for the high and highest level officials, owing to obstruction at the UN Security Council. And a story that came out yesterday that was new and I think indicative of the direction we may be going is not just the Russians and the Chinese blocking a measure at the council to investigate or to condemn Assange for the use of chemical weapons, but also Bolivia and three other countries abstaining from the condemnation. Trump is not a person who has any grasp of what's going on in the region, never has. The fact that he's now the president doesn't change his his lack of understanding of the region or his tendency toward autocracy, his preference for conspiracy and simplistic explanations. And I think he hasn't really announced any clear Syria policy, but I don't think that that's necessarily indicative of a hidden strategy, as he had claimed with his so-called Islamic State strategy, but more that he just doesn't have one, and almost guessing what it might be is a fruitless exercise because he has no idea. Beyond the obvious tendency toward so-called stability through strongman strength and repression, which is exactly how Assad and Putin have effectively won, or at least changed the war in a way that makes it impossible to see a plausible and peaceful removal of the leadership and accountability down the line.
Leila?
So I've been working in the Middle East the last 11 years, and I was most recently in Egypt for 5 years and covered Libya and Tunisia. And I think we all kind of can see that there is no actual policy in the Middle East, but a lot of the autocrats that I covered in the Middle East recognize themselves in the new leader of the United States. And so I think there may be a lot of fear from Muslims based on the very clear, like, Muslims are bad kind of policies that we're hearing from the Trump administration. But the actual leadership, I think, sees an opportunity. The U.S. has long at least played at being the sheriff when it comes to the human rights. They might not follow through, but they'll give you the slap on the wrist, don't jail those journalists, that kind of thing. That maybe doesn't exist anymore. And as was mentioned earlier, for the first time, we're talking about similar issues right here in the United States. So people like Sisi and other leaders like him may see this as an opportunity to say, hey, the U.S., who has not listened to us when we said that the Muslim Brotherhood, the biggest political opponent of the administration there, is a terrorist organization, maybe now they'll say, yeah, it is a terrorist organization, which will have huge ramifications not only in the region, but also here in the United States and Canada, where organizations have connections to this, not only religious, but political organizations. So when I look at that's what has struck me so far, this sort of eagerness almost, especially, you know, Sisi was one of the first leaders, I think maybe the first leader that called. There was like a video, a call, and a telegram. Sisi did the call, Putin did the telegram, and Netanyahu did the video. I think that's what it was.
Someone tweeted.
Yeah, someone else tweeted. So that's what I really see. A lot of this type of language that I heard in the Middle East, and now that I'm back in the States, I'm now hearing here in English from this administration.
Mohamad?
So I'm working on a book about the competition and the conflict between Saudi Arabia and Iran and how it's helped define the region in the last decade, and actually really the last four decades or so since the revolution in 79. I think one of the ways it pertains to what's going on today, well, I'll back up for a minute because I just had a conversation about this before we got to the stage, where I was forced to summarize my argument in two sentences. And when I'm forced to do that, I say this, that it's often misunderstood as a purely sectarian conflict, as this deep-rooted, deeply held conflict between Sunnis and Shia, and that therefore it can never be resolved because it goes back 1400 years, which that part of the conflict does. But most of the time it is actually a political competition. It's a political battle between the two for power projection in the region and for influence in the region. And we see the Trump administration is going to have to make some decisions, and Trump is going to have to make some decisions on that very soon. And one of the things he's one of his priorities has been containing Iran, which has actually done very destructive things in the region in the past few decades, but certainly in the last 6 years or so, I mean, since the Syria war, as Ben and others have documented, and all of us here had done some, all of us in the room have done some elements of this, of what Iran has done in different parts of the region. But what Trump will end up facing is this problem of his number one goal, he says, is also to defeat ISIS. And when he tries to do that on the ground, especially in Iraq and in Syria now, which looms even larger, he's not going to be able to achieve both things at once. He's not going to be able to effectively confront ISIS and at the same time isolate Iran and take on Iran in the way that he thinks he wants to, or he says he wants to do. And also he doesn't want to commit a lot of US troops. So all those three things together are not going to work. And Iran can cause a lot of trouble for the US in the small scaled down presence it has in Iraq now, in all over the region. And also it can unwind a lot of what's been done against ISIS in Iraq and Syria. So I think we need to watch how, and as we've seen so far, this is not an administration that handles nuance too well. So it's going to be a big problem.
Thank you. I think history has taught us that you can ignore the Middle East, but the Middle East won't ignore you. Many presidents have been challenged, surprised by it, often early in their administrations. Certainly, you can say that about Obama, and you can say that about George W. Bush. When you look at the region now, there's no pressing problem, but I'm sure neither president saw that either. Obama didn't see the Arab Spring, and George W. didn't see 9/11. Do you see anything on the horizon now, from Iran to Syria to the Russians to ISIS, that could be the issue that causes the administration to actually define its policy, or at least have to make some kinds of decisions that will define, you know, where Trump is going in the Middle East, something that is you know, building that you can see?
That's a hard question.
Could I answer the opposite of that question?
Sure.
So I see the political, this week, today, the UN Commission of Inquiry released its report on Aleppo, the fall of Aleppo, the so-called evacuation of Aleppo, which it concluded after thorough investigation and documentation was the evacuation itself was a crime against humanity and a war crime, because the actual legal term for what happened was a forced displacement. Fact is, and this is not a condemnation of that, they've done extraordinary work and they take the time to do what they need to do in the time to the level of evidence that they require. But other parts of the UN, the UN Security Council, this fact that it was a forced displacement was obvious in real time. There's no question what was happening. There were clear reports, credible reports from the UN of executions of people who were trying to leave. There were months in which the Russians and Syrians were dropping leaflets in the area saying, if you don't leave, then we will annihilate you. That fits the definition in the Rome Statute, the International Criminal Court's founding document, of what a forced displacement is. So as it was happening, however, the UN Security Council effectively endorsed the Russian and Syrian war crime of forced displacement by calling it an evacuation, and then unanimously approving a resolution that not only referred to it as evacuation, but stressed all kinds of facets that were totally out of touch with reality, saying, you know, it's important that it be safe and voluntary for the civilians. All that to say, there's a widening gap between reality that's directly before us and the necessary moral actions required to address those as gravely and to the level of truth that they need to be addressed. And I think that that's growing. And the every failure in Syria contributes to the inability of these institutions to represent their fundamental founding principles and creates an environment in which future war crimes can be perpetrated with impunity all over the world, creates a gap in credibility of the institutions that we claim to support, which then can be exploited by not just Russia and Syria, but by the United States. And I think that all of the problems, I don't think that I'm articulating this very clearly, but I worry that when the fundamental institutions crumble by way of obstruction, then we have not only no accountability but no credibility, and that this will have severe ramifications in other places.
Leila, what Ben's describing is what you might call a slow fuse, and those are all the kind of events, you know, the lack of credibility with institutions, economic repression, you know, human rights violations, all those things led to an explosion in Egypt in 2011. Mm-hmm. Are all these things such a slow fuse that the Trump administration actually gets a pass? And the region is bubbling, but nothing so terrible.
Well, I think, yes, the Arab Spring happened in 2011, under the Obama administration. This war has been raging on for years. People have in Syria, and this last administration didn't have a very effective policy and has been widely criticized for that. I actually think what this is a world where everybody's looking inward now. Populism, we care about ourselves, we care about our own citizens, we don't care about anybody else, we want to stay inside. And some of the policies that have been implemented so far, the banning of these countries, those types of things, have caused concerns among some, saying, well, will this provoke a possible attack that it says it will stop, right? And I think the thing that will make the Trump administration look at the Middle East differently, maybe dangerously, I don't know, is if there is some type of attack on American soil, honestly. I think that will change and focus the policy in a different way. Right now, it's very hard to predict where it will look, where the administration will look, because it hasn't communicated policy. It doesn't have ambassadors in many embassies. Nobody really knows what the foreign policy goals are, except that he doesn't want to look at the rest of the world. He wants to look at America first. So I think there's that. And I think a lot of what you talked about, the slow fuse, is that there is no international COP, as America has often been portrayed to be. So maybe that.
This is an administration that is actually stuffed with people, military people, who have Iran at the top of their to-do list. They certainly did when they came into the administration. And many of them felt Iran personally from fighting in Iraq. Certainly you can say that about the Secretary of Defense and McMaster's. Can this administration tame Iran, roll back Iran? Can you talk a little bit about the dynamic between the Iranian leadership, what they see when they look at Washington, and how they're responding to Trump, and whether he can, or they can, roll back Iranian power, strong as it's maybe ever been in the region?
I think one of the dangers we're talking about is that we have two administrations, two sets of leaderships that now are really prone to overreaching. Because the Iranians have a history of it. I mean, they have a history of it that they tested those ballistic missiles two weeks into the administration, because they had to start seeing the red lines. They had to see what the reaction would be, and that's dangerous. And they see this rhetoric, and they're still, in Iran, they're still in this post-revolutionary phase of. Constantly here, and I wish Farnaz made it tonight because she could have given us more insight on that inner workings. But that overreach is really dangerous, and also the sense that, we see this with Trump, the sense of honor and humiliation. It's very tribal. I would say, I'm not going to say it's almost Arab, because it's tribal in the sense of Ibn Khaldun. It's this sense of, he felt personally injured by the treatment of those sailors and being, obviously the violation of the Geneva Conventions, and it shouldn't have been done. But that's something that you could tell sticks in his mind, and certainly, to the military brass around him, that also has special resonance. But to him, this seems to be about honor, and he's not going to let the Iranians humiliate him. And that's a wild card that hopefully Mattis and McMaster can rein in to an extent. But again, it goes back to ultimately, my guess is that they'll muddle through for a while, that he'll keep ISIS as this priority, and he'll realize, or the generals will impress upon him, or he'll focus attention on something else, that it's not going, there's not going to be much progress against ISIS without, if you're also going to take on Iran at the same time. And I think that's one of the important things about those generals that have that experience with Iran and Iraq, because over that time, I think they realized how Iran operates, and they realized the kind of levels that Iran can play at the same time, the political levels, the military ones, the supporting everyone, and those of us who spent time in Iraq see that, and we sort of see other places where it's echoed, whether it's Lebanon or Yemen a little bit now. But I think those generals know that, and they realize that it's not as easy as it may sound. There's something else about Leila's point about, sort of attacks, the potential for attacks in the U.S. In some ways, because of Trump's response now, he's not quite, he is leaving, he's giving ISIS such leverage over him by this idea of, because it's guaranteed to, any attack is guaranteed in the US, is guaranteed to unleash a huge reaction. And it's almost, it's so incredibly tempting for them to try to do something or instigate someone. I mean, more likely they'll instigate someone. And so once they do that, they know that the response is going to be huge. And that's really unfortunate, but he's put the country in this situation now.
Well, in some ways it's madmen against madmen, right? So we haven't had a president unpredictable. Mm-hmm. And we haven't had a president that's this unpredictable since Nixon, and he meant it. You know, that was a policy, that was an approach, that you are the madman and you scare your allies and your enemies, and that's a way to do things. And there's some who say that this is essentially what he's doing. That, you know, do not be fooled by the chaos, that there is a method in all of this. And I wanted to ask if that actually will win him some successes in the region. For example, you know, right now the Russians are a bit, you know, off kilter about what he's doing. Is he going to go along with them on Syria? Is he not? How is this all going to play out? Because they can see what we can see. How can you be friends with the Russians and friends with the Iranians at the same time in Syria? You can't. And I wondered if you, when you watch this, and the way that he is playing Syria, where he doesn't really care if the Russians and Assad won there. He doesn't. He's not said that that's a terrible thing. In fact, he's said that's a pretty good thing. We'll just do a couple of safe zones and, you know, we'll fix it all. So I wondered if, as tough as it's been for you to watch this, and it is tough to watch human rights violations that are so blatant, that actually he may be able to end a terrible war because he has no ideology.
He has no ideology. He might, but we don't know the extent of the leverage over him with respect to his relationship with Russia. Absolutely, they're on edge because he's completely unpredictable. Whereas with Nixon, that was a strategy. I'm not sure that every bit of Trump's chaos is a strategy. I think a lot of it is he just has no fucking idea. I mean, but the one thing that he is doing, which speaks to something that you were discussing a moment ago, is he seems to be creating the environment not only in which ISIS has a lot of leverage over him in terms of his reaction to an attack, but the kind of environment that fuels an attack. Advocating the murder of the families, creating what is pretty close to effectively a Muslim ban. When you have Customs and Border Patrol asking people if they're Muslim, even though it's not part of the order, they're asking people if they're Muslim in airports. That's illegal. They're doing it. This is the environment that's almost calling for something. He deals in conspiracy, but with respect to, it's a good point that his unpredictability could be a factor in some reservations for Assad and for Putin in the commission of further war crimes, but only if they actually think that he cares about those things. And I don't think that anyone really thinks he cares about those things. And as I said, we don't know the extent of the leverage.
And I'll ask you the same question, Leila, but let's just shift it just a teeny bit east, and that is, so there's so many contradictions in the Middle East, you know, how do you work out Syria with Russia on one side and Iran on the other if you're America? Turkey, same problem. How do you figure out how to take on Raqqa when you have to decide between the Turks and the Kurds? Do you think that there's no clear policy? Does he get some time and does he get some leverage simply by being this unpredictable? And you know, you can take that to Egypt as well. You know, Sisi is just, he sees his mirror image like, wow. This well, is I the think, boys club.
Yeah, I think there is kind of a debate. Is like, is Trump Morsi? Is Trump Sisi? Depending, like, there are different comparisons going on. But I don't know that, I mean, the idea that there is a method to the madness, I don't know that there is a method. I don't know what he knows about Turkey-Kurdish relationship. I don't know any of that stuff. But I do think...
The grown-ups know.
Well, who are the... Yeah, but who's... I don't know who's in his ear. Is it Mattis and McMaster, or is it Bannon and... I don't know those things, and I don't think any of us know those things. So I think... But I think, like Mohamad was saying, everybody's going to be testing their boundaries right now. I think everybody's going to be making their demands for their domestic... pleas that they were not able to get under the last administration, and everybody is angling right now. And he only has a limited amount of time and grace period before he has to have some type of policy that will not make Saudi feel that they're being, Iran is being chosen over Saudi, Saudi being chosen over Iran. Bad example, because Iran's clearly not going to be chosen over Saudi. But you get what I'm saying. So this grace period is limited, and I don't know that he is dealing with the Middle East with any type of nuance, and I think the other leaders get that. They're like, now is our time to explain the Arab world to this man in our viewpoint.
Can I ask you, Mohamad, you know, we read that a lot of the Gulf states, they like him. They think that, you know, he will be good to them. The UAE loves hearing that they're considering making the Muslim Brotherhood a terrorist organization. Egypt, like, yes, that's a great idea. Do you think that he will ultimately disappoint them, or, you know, he will make, his policies are will be popular in parts of the Arab world?
I think it's most likely to be both. He'll disappoint them in some ways, and he'll continue to be popular. I mean, we're seeing some disappointment already because, lo and behold, some people in the Arab world, quite a few people actually supported him, and then they're surprised when he does what he says he planned to do in week one. And that's a little disappointing. I mean, that's not on the state level. That's more with people who, you know, sort of thought. I think that the rhetoric about getting the U.S. out of the region, getting U.S. resources out, I mean, he went to this yesterday. I mean, he exaggerated how much the U.S. actually spent on the wars, but he definitely, that populist theme of, you know, we're going America first, and the theme that he comes back to all the time, that resonates in the sense that people are tired of U.S. meddling in the Middle East, and it was nice and refreshing to hear him say that. I think even some off-the-cuff things he said a few relatively honest things during some of the debates and things that resonated. I mean, in some ways he said something, do you remember the comment that he said it's a real estate deal, Israel and the Palestinians? I mean, in some ways it is. In some ways, it's, I mean, that's, hey, nothing else has worked in the last 60 years. And that resonates, but I think ultimately he'll disappoint them because I'm not quite sure if the, I mean, a lot of what the Gulf states are most excited about is, I think they were unfair in their perception of Obama. Obama didn't turn the U.S. toward Iran, and I think they thought that he did because of the nuclear deal and because of the lead up to that, and because he didn't confront Iran, and he didn't have the rhetoric. And Trump has the rhetoric. I'm not quite sure he's going to live up to the rhetoric, and I think that's where they're going to be disappointed. I think one thing that's just kind of been underlying, I'm just thinking about this, hearing our discussion so far, and it'll be interesting what people have, I think, I'm interested in hearing how people perceive this, but there is this perception in the U.S., and I think it's coming back. We may not hear it quite as clearly now, but we heard it for a long time, which is that the Arabs need a strong man, right? That the Arabs need a strong man to control them. There was a book, there were many books, but there was a book that was out, had the unfortunate timing of being published a few months before the revolutions. It was called The Dark Horse or The Strong Horse or something like that, something horse, about how the Arabs need a strong man. And that's such a, I mean, aside being Orientalist and racist caricature and so simplistic. And but it's in vogue again, partly because there are strong men distributed everywhere in the Arab world, and we've sort of, at least for now, seem to have lost the will for the kind of the democracy versus stability argument that went on for so long. And they'll be in vogue again because Trump is a strong man, sort of, here. And he's clearly gravitating toward most of the strong men in the region. But that, I think I would caution that in the long term, that's not gonna last. And that's because if there's one small bit of hope out of the revolutions in 2011, is that the Arabs actually rose up and said they don't like the strongmen and they don't want to bear with it. And they were crushed all over, and every country had a different scenario, but I think they proved once and for all that they don't like living under the strongmen.
Look ahead just a little bit, Ben, and let's start with Syria. Mm-hmm. I thought it was interesting today that the negotiations in Geneva aren't going well because people said, oh, the Americans aren't here. Everybody thought they could do it without the United States, but maybe they can't. That, you know, we still need some.
But did we have that much of a presence in the past 6 months? The last 6 months of Obama's presidency, I don't recall exactly because I've been working on something outside of Syria for a while now, but I think that previous meetings, at least, were arranged without really U.S. presence in the past. We've kind of like worked our way out of relevance there, at least in terms of having any sway over the situation. Cement the power spent the past 5 years condemning atrocity after atrocity on the floor of the UN Security Council, but what did that do besides make headlines? I think there is a glimmer of hope in that Trump has no ideology and so he's so easily swayed. And if Morning Joe and Fox and Friends just started inviting like tons of Middle East experts to come fill their 3 hours, and all of them were also sort of put down their academic hats for a second and just talked really plainly about how stupid it was to do certain things and how a Muslim ban is going to actually help ISIS recruit, and just really explain it in really basic terms, but also embarrassing him for his current policies because he responds to public embarrassment and he wants to be loved. I think that's our best hope is like, but it's achievable. It's just that morning television has to be better.
Ben, you're putting way too much faith in the Middle East experts.
And it also sounds like, you know, we are living with an alcoholic father.
I'm still trying to figure out why he hasn't responded to the goading from the Oscars. So something is shifting.
But where I was going with this is, you know, some things are moving on their own, whether Trump engages or not. One of them is we are moving towards a settlement in Syria. We can kind of see where it's going.
Yeah, Assad wins.
You know, Assad wins. Russia has a presence. Iran has a presence.
They get big reconstruction contracts.
The region has to deal with it. Yeah. ISIS is not the ISIS it was a while ago. And so this will be for you, Leila. What do you see in the region as these are big changes, actually? We don't pay a whole lot of attention to them because they all come in increments. But if you look in general, you do see that, you know, ISIS is essentially being contained as a caliphate. Mm-hmm. There'll be something else. They don't disappear, but all those headlines that we all wrote, that part is over. And so how does that play out in the region? Do we see the Turks and the Russians become closer? Does it shift the plates?
Yeah. Well, I think these things are cyclical, right? And in working in Iraq, we would see the same issue reemerge after the Band-Aid. So this is another Band-Aid situation, right? Assad wins, it's contained, people are fully repressed in certain areas of Syria, too scared to talk, jailed or dead, and therefore it's contained for the time being with the stamps of the main superpowers of the region. Iraq, Mosul, a lot of it taken back land-wise, again, it's contained, but the issue that brought this in the first place, where a government was treating its citizenry so badly that people would rather have had this force in power in their area, is not necessarily solved. And the issue of the strongman, like Mohamad was saying, that people wanted a voice, they wanted citizenship, they tried, it was met with varying degrees of either acceptance or brutalities. Because we saw a pattern happen during the uprisings. It started in Tunisia where a leader fled, everybody in the Middle East was shocked, oh my gosh, this autocrat left. And that is sort of the semblance of success. Went to Egypt, the US and the Egyptian military stepped away from Mubarak. Mubarak's deposed. I'm sure a lot of American allies were like, wait a second, the US stepped away from him. What does this mean for us? He left. Assad said, no, I'm going to stay. And ultimately, years later, it has worked. And all of the strongmen that have returned, like Sisi, are now going that path. So I think all of the underlying issues that led to that original uprising in 2011 have not been solved. The underlying issue of the Syrian civil war has not been solved, but there is a Band-Aid. How long will that Band-Aid last is the question, and who will ally during those times?
Mohamad?
I don't think I have anything to add.
Oh, I thought you were going to majorly disagree with me.
No.
Fair enough. What I'd like to do is open it up to the floor, and I know that we have a student who will be the first questioner. And if you can, come to the microphone so we can hear you. We probably can, but let's not test that. And if you would say your name and frame your question.
Hi, I'm Murat. I'm a Turkish journalist. Thank you so much for being with us.
And a member of the Overseas Press Club.
Yes, thankfully. Thanks, Gabby. So basically, the situation in Turkey, as you all know, is becoming very, very difficult for journalists. I used to be on some sort of a blacklist, and I'm only a Turkish national, but the problem persists for American citizens or foreign journalists as well. They get returned from the airport when they're trying to land and enter the country. Some of their visas get revoked. So my question is not about general analysis, but rather about journalism and covering these countries. What are alternative ways of covering a country such as Turkey when you're not on the ground? Is there a way or way of finding sources when, for example, somewhere in Europe? If you've done any of this, I'd really appreciate examples. And I have the Assad files in mind as well when I'm asking this question. Could you talk a little bit about that, Ben, and how you got in touch with the sources and how you got the files?
Sure. So that was a story I wrote. It was published about a year ago, and it was about a war crimes investigation. And it involved the use of about 600,000. I didn't see all 600,000, but this group of war crimes investigators smuggled 600,000 Syrian government documents out of security and intelligence facilities that had been taken over, were contained in rebel territory, essentially, and abandoned by the regime. They also had some documents from a mole in Damascus. So I didn't go to Syria for that story at all. I was in an office in Western Europe. They had done the perilous work of smuggling this stuff out. They had lost someone in that operation. They had a couple of people that were kidnapped but have later been freed. I guess it's worth, I mean, Turkey's not in that situation. It's not like Syria, obviously, but as you said, like, you can't necessarily go back and do your job, certainly not openly. In the case of Syria, because there was such a mass exodus, there were people that had taken such volumes of information with them, whether these files from the investigation or in the case of something else I worked on, these doctors who had 50,000 photos and videos that they'd taken inside Syrian hospitals. They had moved out because of the war. So the fact is, like, if you want to do stories on Syria, it's very easy to find refugees who have been in detention facilities in Europe, or detained in Syria, but are now in Europe. I mean, you can find every source you want. You can find intelligence agents in Europe, Syrian intelligence agents. You can find pretty much everything. But in the case of Turkey, where people have left, you don't have the same kind of exodus. I don't really have a good answer. I don't know. Perhaps either of you would, in terms of building sources.
Well, there's no good answer to that question, because the best thing is to be on the ground, which is why leaders will try to bar journalists and shut down domestic journalists and bar foreign journalists. It's the most effective way to poke holes. Even if your reporting is rock solid, it's easy to be like, but you know, she's never set foot in Istanbul, so why should you listen to her? So it's the easiest way. And I also think it's some of the hardest journalism, because it's the hardest to check, you know, because a lot of the times when somebody is leaking you information from outside of the country of origin, they've chosen a side and they have this information. And as we all know, people don't tell us things because they like us. They tell us things because they have a purpose, they have a goal. So we saw a lot of that in the early days of the uprising when we first couldn't get into Libya, when things just started popping in Syria. And we had to do that by finding sources through people we know, who, you know, games of telephone, right? 6 degrees of separation type things. But then trying to truth vet that through other sources, so it's quite difficult. I feel like Deb is probably the best person to talk about this, because you covered Syria for so long.
Well, I actually think, you know, Turkey has become quite vigorous in cracking down on Western journalists.
Yeah, what happened to Diane, the Wall Street Journal reporter.
And Rod Marland, yeah. You know, was stopped at the border. He probably knew that was going to happen. And you know, I think what he did in terms of journalism was quite brave. You know, he went to Diyarbakir. That is the most underreported story now that there is in Turkey. And it is relevant. It has to do with Turkish policy towards the Kurds, and it is getting very little coverage because it's almost impossible to do. I think, you know, maybe even the OPC should say something about what's happening. I know today at NPR they were having a meeting about this, because we have a correspondent based in Istanbul and an assistant and some freelancers there, and there's really concern that they're all going to get kicked out. So far, Turkey's been impervious to any kind of pressure that I know of. They just don't, I mean, the government just doesn't care. And it's almost impossible to, all you get to do is name and shame. Yeah. And it just may mean that now is the time to begin developing those kind of sources. I think if there was more coverage, Turkey's such a funny country to cover anyway. You know, I had an assistant that I worked with in Istanbul who in her graduate courses at Duke asked her political science professor, why doesn't anybody write about Turkey? And he said, because you can't do the sentence at the top of your piece that says Turkey, comma, like. There's no answer. There's no answer to what you put in those commas. And so you have to explain everything every time. It is such a unique political system, the role that it plays in the region. So I just say maybe this is the time to do more coverage.
Hi, good evening. I'm Dazzle. I'm doing my master's in sustainability management at Columbia. My question is, as US gets more energy independent or sufficient, their interest in Middle East will reduce or is likely to reduce. And how does that change the geopolitical situation?
I feel like that question's for you.
I think that question is asked you for Ali Shahabi.
Let me be sure I understand the question. It is on as our dependence reduces.
Yes, I think if you go back a little bit at the history, one of the reasons why U.S. had a major interest in the Middle East was because of oil. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. And now that U.S. gets more and more energy independent, their interest in the Middle East should reduce or will likely reduce. And that really should change the geopolitical situation going forward.
If we have question marks in the panel, this is hive brain. you Middle East correspondents. Does anybody want to answer that? Anybody?
Well, I think the main relationship that will be affected is the Saudi-U.S. relationship, which has been quite strong for all these years, and I think there's a lot of concern moving forward if that changes, if the U.S. becomes less dependent on oil. What does that say about this relationship? I mean, that would be my, and how that shifts everything.
I'm also not sure that you're right, there was a strong, the geopolitics of oil was a really important part of the relationship early on, but I think it's moved beyond that, and the U.S. sees itself, rightfully or not, as having really enormous interests in the Middle East beyond oil. And I guess one of the reasons I think Trump's rhetoric was well-received is he kind of stepped back from that, but we see he's not really following through. I think one interesting parallel is to look at it's not a perfect parallel, but Reagan administration in Latin America in the 80s, and in some ways the dictators of Latin America saw the Reagan administration as basically carte blanche to unleash whatever they could. And I think that's where naming and shaming no longer really works anymore, because Trump has destroyed that card now with the travel ban and with detaining French philosophers and professors at the airport and trying to deny them entry. And is Turkey going to care or Egypt going to care when someone denounces them out of the U.S.? They'll turn around and say, look at Trump.
But to be fair, that was starting. We were starting to see that even a year and a half, 2 years ago, where it was like the U.S.'s bluffs were being called a little bit. And so, when there was not much improvement on human rights records in Egypt, and the money still came back in military aid. So there was a little bit of that. But the naming and shaming stuff, yeah, exactly. Now that the U.S. does a lot of the things that they once criticized, it's empty. And being the recipient of U.S. foreign policy is not particularly fun all the time. We cover the region where what policy is decided here is then implemented, and you watch the after effects of that. And the people who live in that region are very aware of that. And so there was, as Mohamad said, this sort of idea that maybe he was a less interventionist president, meaning it will affect my life better, possibly.
Although it's been chilling to watch the UN vote, where you actually had people vote against sanctions for using chlorine in Syria. And a lot of the writings that I saw said, well, then what stops anybody now from using chemicals? If you keep it to chlorine, VX in an airport in Malaysia is kind of a bad idea. And that got really people more agitated than using a little bit of chlorine in Syria. That wasn't so bad, was it? We all survived them not actually condemning it at the UN. And it loosens the norms.
Yeah.
It loosens the norms. That side of the room?
Yes. Hi, my name is Riham. I'm from Syria. I'm doing my MA in politics and global affairs at Columbia Journalism School. And commenting on your question about reporting while you're not in the country, I start most of my reporting about Syria after I left Syria, because in Syria I couldn't do anything but the regime propaganda or the editing news or things, which is just writing news as the regime wants, while I was working there as a journalist. Most important is to have resources on ground, which are normal people who are your friends, who you left there, who you speak their language, and then you have the trust, and you can always ask what is going on there. Do you have anyone who could help me? I did most of my reporting in the past 2 years about Syria while I was in Germany after I left, and it's so frustrating. And for me personally, I'm thinking about leaving journalism or doing something else, not about the Middle East, because after 2 years you start to lose contact with what's happening in the ground, and it's frustrating, but it's doable. So I have two questions. First, for Ben, and about covering Syria. How can we stop or not fall into normalizing Assad now because we want peace? How could confront that? Having peace while having him is not peace. And we have tens of thousands of people are underground being killed under torture because of him, and this is not peace. And how like journalism lately, especially after Aleppo, is trying to say like he's not that bad, it's just the best option. How can we fall into that? Because I see New York Times also are falling into that. My second question is for all of you: how could we confront the frustration when we are covering a hopeless region like the Middle East? How can we cover Syria for 6 years and then say like? Having the idea that we will make a change, and nothing changed. It was just like getting worse every day. How could we like continue working while we're saying our work is just telling people that it's very bad situation there, but no one is going to do anything? How could we confront that? Thank you.
You can start.
Yeah, you're absolutely right. I've, with respect to anything I've been working on related to the government, I'm in a bit of a lucky position, which is that I don't write that often. So I don't have to write, I don't write news stories on a daily or even weekly basis where the news is something besides what the government is doing. So, like, I feel like I'm not a good person to answer this because I specifically write about Syria through the lens of war crimes. And so that's not something that I think about that much because the government is the actor that is committing war crimes on the most widespread and systematic level. And so that's the only thing that I really focus on. I would imagine it's different if you have to cover sort of news every day, and the fact that Assad is the president and the Syrian government has committed these war crimes is not really the point of the news of the day. So I don't really know how to confront that because I'm not doing it.
I think normalization has already begun. Yeah. You saw Stephen Kinzer writing about the white helmets. You saw the, I guess, is she the mother or the aunt of Ayman Kurdi? And she talked about, you know, how can you keep funding these terrorists in Syria? There are growing voices because there's a political shift coming. Probably by this summer, there's already the Russians are asking for for reconstruction money. And the phrase that I have heard in conferences on Syria is, it is better to have an unjust peace than a just war. It's a nice bumper sticker, and it explains what price that we will all pay to just stop the violence. And you've certainly heard even Obama officials talking like this, not before the end of the last administration. So yes, we're on our way to normalizing Assad.
But then we have at least 6-7 million people left Syria because of Assad, not because of war. Those people are afraid now in Europe and in Germany and Lebanon and Jordan. They are not there because there's war. They are there because they are afraid of Assad. So we're not solving this problem at all. It's just keeping people under, like hostages under Assad, who couldn't leave. Not, they didn't want to leave, so.
Most refugee crises now are on average last for 17 years. So it's not a surprise that there'll be a lot of Syrians who will remain in Germany and Sweden and Norway and all the places that they ended up. And you know, at the end of the day, most people spend their 17 years in really terrible refugee camps. So I'm not condoning any of this, but I'm saying that, you know, at least they got themselves to Sweden and their kids are going to school. But it is the way of the world. People win these wars and they lose these wars. They're always messy at the end, but you kind of feel that it's moving towards some kind of resolution. I don't think that we can see what the outlines are yet because there's still a way to go because Raqqa is still in the hands of ISIS and that's inside Syria. It's not clear, you know, how the Kurdish areas end up or who rules them or if there's safe zones. Those are all very important questions. But this is, you know, this is not like it was a year ago. It feels like we're moving towards some resolution. There are some people who say that you can't, that Assad can't go until there is a resolution, that the Russians won't let him go until there is one.
And also, I think conflating the conversation is changing. I don't necessarily think the media is normalizing Assad. I mean,
I'm not saying the media is.
Exactly, but the question was framed this way. I mean, you and many others have documented tirelessly the number of war crimes, the types of things that are happening in Syria, and that these are the fault of Assad. But the conversation has, by the politicians, has been about ISIS. That's been the conversation. And the conversation is about how to keep myself safe. And if I'm keeping myself safe, then I need to make sure it's kind of stable over there. And that's the way the conversation has shifted.
Anything to add, Mohamad?
No, I think we covered.
This side.
Hi, Alan Don Trank. I'm a former president of the OPC. Thank you all. I'd like you guys to discuss whether it's just me when I think that Iran has become way more powerful in the last year to 18 months as a clandestine force in the region, whether it's the March of the Houthis or what's going to happen in Palestine next or even what might happen in Egypt. Is that just my imagination or is that in fact what's going on?
I'm not sure if it's just to the last 18 months. I would say it's really the last, since 2003. Since the Iraq invasion. I mean, the biggest winner of the Iraq invasion was Iran.
The Syrian intervention with the Russians seems to have given it a whole nother
But Iran has been involved in all of the places, less so, it's not much of a factor in Egypt, really, or in Palestine, not much anymore. I mean, there's a connection with Islamic Jihad. There's sort of a love-hate relationship with Hamas, but I don't think they have much influence over Palestine anymore. It's more Iraq, Syria, Lebanon, Yemen, maybe Bahrain to an extent. That was a more popularly based rebellion and the Iranians got involved in some ways. But yes, I mean, there's a little bit of a narrative that Iran has gotten stronger. I think it's been getting stronger for a decade. Part of that, I think the unspoken part of, if I'm reading between the lines of your question, I think part of that narrative has been that it's gotten stronger because of the nuclear agreement and because Obama let it get stronger.
Well, no, that's really not underlying it. I'm more interested in what the effect of Russia and the Saudi opposition to the Iranians having on the whole dynamic.
In Syria specifically, or broadly in the region as a whole?
Is Syria like, you know, one of these horror movies where there's the glowing nuclear mass and from there the monsters spread?
I mean, I think it's indirectly strengthened Iran to an extent, but also there might come a time when Russia will sell out Iran in Syria. I mean, that might happen. I don't see the scenario immediately. I don't see it. But Russian interests aren't really to sort of strengthen Iran. Russian interests are to preserve Russian interests in Syria, in the Mediterranean, in Assad. The Iranians have been there have been some moments when the Iranians have been uncomfortable. I mean, I don't know all the ins and outs of this, but some of the delays of the withdrawal from Aleppo were militias that basically answer to Iran and that were thwarting it. And I think the Russians were pretty angry in December at different points at the Iranians because the Iranians didn't feel they were getting their fair due and also the militias. So Iran has gotten stronger over the past decade. Maybe it's gotten a little bit stronger in the past year or so. But also Iran sometimes overreaches, and that's what we were talking about earlier about Trump and Iran and that dynamic. So I'm not sure. Is that, okay. I'm not sure what, I might be missing an element of
no,
what you're asking.
No, you're not missing anything.
Others.
I mean, I would agree with that.
Thank you.
This side. Hi, thank you for coming to speak to us today. I have a question. I think it's mostly for Deborah and Leila. Could you speak to the specific hurdles of being a female reporter in the region? I'm a journalism student. I'm from Jordan, so I'd be interested to hear about some of the barriers you've encountered because of that.
I remember in 2006, I spoke on a panel with Helen Thomas, and she said that she's never been anything but a female journalist, so she can't really answer that question, because I don't know what it's like to be a man. But I actually think I really feel it's better, in the sense that I get access to the entire population, because men who typically maybe don't mix, if they're from a particularly conservative part of society, will speak to you as a female journalist, but you also have access to the women in the home. If you're in somebody's home, you can speak to those women. In a more less conservative area, obviously that doesn't apply, but I felt that, especially in Iraq. I also felt like, you know, things that were simple, like covering my hair, helped me just blend in easier, whereas a man can't put a scarf on his head if he's blonde, for example. I mean, in general, I blended in more because I'm Lebanese. But so that I think is helpful. But obviously, we are more vulnerable when it comes to things like sexual assault, which became quite evident in some of these protests where it gets out of hand. So there is that issue, but overall, working in the region, I've always found being a woman very helpful.
I agree. You know, when we were in Iraq, I could put on an abaya and disappear, and my male colleagues, the blonde ones, were in the kitchen dyeing their hair.
And that did not work.
Which,
let me just tell you, that
many
never
times
worked.
It would go green on them.
Yeah.
There was just no way that they could disappear, so that was an advantage. And, you know, I'm old enough to be one of the first women to go out to the Middle East when it was, you know, all the guys. And I think over time, editors realized that we actually had an advantage. You know, by 91, the first Gulf War, all of a sudden, the press corps was even for the first time. And you saw different stories mm-hmm. when that happened. Now, you know, I think in war zones, sometimes, you know, there is a disadvantage. There's only so big of a pack that I can carry. There's only so fast that I can run, out of a war zone. But, you know, the difference between a male and a female in really dangerous circumstances kind of hardly matters.
We all are the same.
You're pretty vulnerable, yeah. You know, no matter what. I think something else has happened with women in journalism is that as time has gone on, you kind of see, you know, men now writing the same things that we do, that's like, oh, that was a good idea. Let's go to talk to the women in the refugee camp. And so that's been interesting to watch that over time. But I would never say to any woman who's going into the profession that it will hold you back, not as a as a foreign correspondent, I don't think so. You may see things a little bit differently, and your priorities in what you cover may be a little bit different, but it's not a disadvantage, not at all.
Thank you.
I have a question that's related to that, which is, okay, so in the field, no disadvantage. What about in the sort of politics of a newsroom? Has that been an advantage? I mean, has it been a disadvantage?
You know, I think some of you have to speak to this more than I can. I worked for National Public Radio, where it's kind of high school numbers, half and half. And it was because when it opened its doors, they didn't pay any money, so they hired a lot of women. That's usually what happened. And those numbers stayed that way. But, you know, I don't know what it's like at The New Yorker. I don't know what it was like at Newsday.
I think that Newsday was pretty good. Tina's husband. We can ask Tina. But also, I mean, what just struck me about that question is, I immediately thought, basically all the great coverage coming out of Syria today is being done by female correspondents.
Yeah, Hoeita, Ann Bernard, Liz Sly.
Yes, yeah. All the war correspondents are women. Yeah. And I think that it's an interesting...
And photographers too, Alice Martins. They're all, I mean, Alice Martins was going into Raqqa long after everyone had been kidnapped. She's, there are a lot of women that I met on the Syrian border who were doing the coverage that men stopped doing months earlier and continue to.
I think male journalists need to go out of their way to understand. They need to find ways to bring female voices into their stories. I mean, that's just because you don't have as immediate access. You need to try to find ways to do that and to do more stories about the rhythms of daily life that are really important, and they're so important because there is the tendency to focus on mayhem and bloodshed in a war zone, and underlying, I mean, it's much more important to convey daily rhythm because, and anytime, I mean, stories I would do, stories any of us would do, colleagues would do, people would be really surprised that, wow, people still shop and one of my favorite, Tina Sussman comes to speak to one of my classes all the time at NYU, and one of my favorite stories, well, several stories, one, she did a story about the guy who runs a flower shop in Baghdad during the war, people who did gastric bypass surgery because it was impossible to exercise. I mean, those things that you see are about daily life. That's because life continues in war, and it continues. And that's ultimately what stays, what you have after the war.
And it's also that kind of reporting, you know, I often think about it is, who would I be? And for the audience back home, they identify much more with getting gastric bypass because you can't exercise and keeping a flower shop running than they do about, you know, who's at the front lines and how's the war going. You know, it's not terribly interesting unless you really care about a particular country. But, you know, if you're an average reader or listener, what really strikes you is, would I be doing this if I was there? And those stories are much more resonant with listeners than almost anything else we do, don't you think?
And what it speaks to is the importance of general diversity in our industry. If you have people of different age, gender, race, religion, you just get a better tapestry because you naturally sort of gravitate as a human being towards things that you relate to, whether it be of your faith or your gender or your whatever. So it just makes for better coverage overall.
Thanks for coming and sharing all these valuable insights with us. My name is Mirai. I'm doing a master's at NYU in Near Eastern Studies. It's not middle, but near for some reason. So I was wondering if you have found yourself ever in a situation when you were concerned about the politics of knowledge production itself. Because like being a journalist on the ground, you're actually functioning as some kind of a filter where this objective reality gets to us. So maybe like the way perhaps you are framing things could have a bearing on who's gonna interest from that or who not. Thanks.
I think about that all the time. I think that we have a platform that is unique and special, and it's getting smaller and smaller because there's less and less platforms for foreign correspondents, and what we write ends up informing what we write, what we broadcast, ends up informing these policymakers negatively or positively. You never know how people are going to interpret what you're writing. Often what I do is just document. You know, I go in and I'm documenting. And sometimes you go in, Libya, for example, I remember going in at the very beginning of the uprising, and it is a country that was closed for 42 years. Meaning there were very few people who really were experts on Libya. And the journalists going in were definitely not. We were going in because of what we had heard and we needed to document it. So that was a really heavy burden, trying to understand the local politics, not being able to call in lots of experts who can really explain the nuances to you and learn as you go. So it is really, it's a huge responsibility because not everybody's standing there with you. So you do, you have to think about that constantly and what effect that may have.
And especially, you know, in like shooting wars, it's going so fast. That even the experts, you know, don't really help you when things are changing.
Yeah, when things are changing so quickly. And yeah, there's so much, especially during the Arab uprisings, like that was so quick. Everything was changing, everything, and it was uncharted territory, and you didn't know what you were dealing with, and nothing was predictable. And then some of the things that were written then informed policy that is now maybe really considered questionable when you look at things like the Libya and the intervention there and how it's turned out. So yeah, it's a big, and that was a big question leading up to the Iraq war as well. Like, what was the media's role at that time? Did they, you know, did they fail? So it's a big
Can I turn that around one minute for Ben? So you spend months documenting in intimate detail war crimes, I mean serious war crimes. You know, and write, that this is the most evidence since Nuremberg. And you put it in a magazine, it gets a lot of attention, and then nothing happens.
Yeah, yeah.
Nothing changes.
Nothing changes. That's almost true. There have been some very, there have been changes in terms of setting the stage for future positive changes, but not actually changing anything in the short term. So for instance, one thing that has happened and that is kind of the only path to any prosecutions right now is a lot of European jurisdictions have taken it upon themselves to investigate war crimes in their own countries, or war criminals who have arrived, because war crimes, there's something called universal jurisdiction. If one of your nationals is a victim of a war crime in a foreign country, you can bring a case. So there's a case that was opened up or brought to court in Spain a couple of weeks ago, and it's the first case to use the Caesar files, mm-hmm. the Caesar photos, and it's because they found a dual national victim in the photos. That one of the victims, and this was really, really difficult because these are photographs, 55,000 photographs that were smuggled out of the country showing around 11,000 unique bodies, but most of them, their faces have been totally destroyed in Syrian government detention facilities. And so you, for the real trial that needs to happen of the security intelligence officers in charge of the security branches where they were being killed, in charge of the hospitals where those bodies were being processed, and ultimately tracing up the chain of command to the president and the highest level security committee, that trial can only happen when there's an international tribunal. But when a Spanish victim is found in those photographs, Spain can bring a case. And so they've brought a case. And if an intelligence agent, a low-level intelligence agent, shows up in the refugee stream in a European jurisdiction, and Spain, this is hypothetical, this hasn't happened, but some of the intelligence agents have been identified, the arrests haven't happened yet. But you know, if Spain hypothetically wanted to found that someone who had shown up in a refugee shelter in Germany had worked at Hospital 601 and was implicated in the case that they had, they could have that person arrested and brought to Spain and they could have a trial today. So that's not happening for the high level officials, but these things are happening at the bottom right now. And I guess the only hope is that, you know, justice is slow and these things take time, but the evidence is there. It does trace directly up the chain of command, and now everybody knows it. So no one can claim they didn't know. And actually, one thing that's interesting for me, every time I watch, I'll never be able to get into like Interview Assad or anything like that, but one thing that I really enjoy about watching when journalists do get access to Assad, often they do ask a question about war crimes. Michael Isikoff from Yahoo News recently went into Damascus, and it was the day after Amnesty International released its huge report on Saydnaya prison and these executions. Now, what he did, what was so important was, and it was important for press, but he asked about this report. He asked about these killings in Saydnaya. And Assad, of course, denied everything and called into question the evidence, which is a predictable answer and is basically useless in terms of coverage. But what really matters from a legal perspective is Assad has been put on notice, so he cannot deny in court that he didn't know about this, because this is a notice evidence that is now admissible in a court. It's like Assad can't deny that he didn't know. And when you prosecute war criminals at the highest level, often, you know, international criminal law takes into account the fact that the highest level perpetrators are rarely present at the scene of the crime. So there's a mode of liability called command control responsibility. That person has to have been in a position to know, to have known, if you knew or should have known that this was happening in your chain of command beneath you.
And did nothing
to stop it, to prevent, or to punish it, you're responsible for those war crimes. So when Isakov brings that amnesty report to Assad and does an interview and Assad says something useless, that can actually serve in a trial down the line, should we ever get to that point.
Okay, that's interesting.
Apologies if this question's already been asked, but one of the great tragedies in Syria is the fact that the international community has focused mostly on ISIS as opposed to the war crimes of Assad, who's responsible for something of 80 to 95% of civilian casualties. My question to you is, are we now in the stage where we're counting down the months before a total Assad victory in Syria? Because there seems to be almost this tacit and sometimes explicit agreement between the last administration and this administration that in Syria, because there is no credible party that we can back to be in power, we are just gonna let this play out.
I think we did kind of answer that.
Yeah. And it looks like that's where we're going.
Yeah.
Thanks.
That's where we're going. If we have one more, and we'll take one more, and because there's still wine out there, we will wrap it up after this.
Why did you say so? Okay, I better ask the question now. It'll look bad if I rush out for the glass. One of the points you were making before about the sort of revisionist idea that this has all been invented, it's also reminiscent of the Balkan Wars. It's deja vu all over again. And if you want to see where fake news is most prevalent on the internet, it's in the so-called left-wingers who are defending Assad and quoting RT and circulating viral videos from RT. It's quite frightening that they and Trump are the same on this one, diminishing the credibility of credible witnesses on this. And getting back to the Balkans on that one, if you remember in the Balkans, the sort of smaller powers on the Security Council forced the reluctant Americans and Russians, because nobody wanted to find genocide, because there are implications, legal implications. We don't have a dog in this fight, as James Baker famously said, and I'm sure somebody is muttering even today in the State Department about Syria. And they actually fought, as a compromise, they allowed Sherif Bassiouni and a commission of investigation into the Balkan Wars. And they produced such a dossier on crimes that in the end, the Security Council was pretty much forced to set up the International Criminal Tribunal in the former Yugoslavia. So that's the back way. But just on a journalistic question, I heard the sound of silence here. There's a sort of basic assumption, and if I may say so, the mainstream media, Saudi Arabia neutral. You'd never guess that Saudi Arabia was a bloodthirsty theocracy that was nurturing Islamic fundamentalists across the world. It looks like the benign alternative to Iran, where we're going to roll back Iran. Now, as a sort of born-again atheist who writes about rum and vodka and tequila, I'm not exactly...
Can I have your job?
Please. It's a tough job, my liver. But it's pro-Iranian. I mean, let's just take a step back from being American and Western. Who's rolling back who? Do the Iranians have a fleet in the Gulf of Mexico? Have the Iranians shot down any airliners flying in our coastal waters almost lately? Have the Iranians funded a neighboring state to fire poison gas at us like we did with the Iraqis? I'm just putting it in perspective that rolling back Iran and treating Iran as though it's the bogey, when Iran is actually the beleaguered party from any objective point of view, regardless of what you think about the Ayatollahs and their habits. But even then, I mean, hey, if you're in Iran, women can drive, they can have jobs, and they do the executions mostly in private and don't kill people on the streets with a beheading. You know, it's a marginal difference. But it's just this emphasis, as though we're soaking up the gestalt from Washington, Iran bad, Saudi good. And then the final one, the complete silence, I think it might have been mentioned once. Across the Middle East, the big issue, why America has no credibility on any issues whatsoever? Israel. And the unlimited defense in the Security Council. The fact that Obama is under siege for expressing letting international law be expressed right across the Middle East. That's what worries people. It's not Iran that worries people. That's what worries people. We have no credibility after Abu Ghraib and years of defensive vetoes. The US has no credibility on human rights and international law. And Trump is not going to address this, of course. And Obama's half-hearted effort right at the end just brought that into attention. But it does not permeate out into this mainstream media or any other media. And it's something, these issues need addressing. They need ventilating, especially if Trump is going to come with his weird settler vision from his son-in-law, if that's what's going to happen.
I sense there's no question there, yeah. But that is not a bad sentiment to sort of wrap up this panel. We are at 9. We can let that stand as our final words, unless any of you have anything more to say.
Well, I don't know that we left. I don't think we said Saudi
Nobody
was
said
good,
Saudi
Iran
was
bad,
benign,
but
yeah.
Oh, but anyway, but plus also, I think, yes, there isn't much U.S. credibility in the region, but Israel hasn't really been part of that for the last 10 years. I mean, it's since the Iraq War, the U.S. has lost credibility for many other reasons, and unfortunately, it's taken a back seat. And, you know, seeing tens and tens of thousands of victims every day in Syria is not, that doesn't do well for the health of the region. And people are much more concerned these days in the region with people dying in Syria than they are with Palestine. I mean, that's the reality now.
Thank you, panelists. Thank you, Ben. Thank you, Leila. Thank you, Mohamad. And thank you, all of you, for staying. We'll settle this next year.
Yes. Settle the Middle East.